yes, I want to introduce someone to you now who is a DJ working his magic on crowds every night at nightclubs around the world until a nearly fatal road accident nearly cost his right arm. He hasn't lost his passion in performing. He's here today to talk about his journey, how he has coped and what he's done. Would you please welcome, in a slightly different form, we're going to introduce him to talk first of all, and then we're going to have a short interview and then invite questions. Ladies and gentlemen, Matt Howe.
Hello, this is very different for me. I've kind of gone through and printed it all out in a very OCD way to hopefully try and get the points across that I want to make, and then afterwards we can have a bit of a chat and yeah, a few questions and answers if you'd like to get involved with that. So I'm going to jump right in because I'm not excellent at public speaking, I'm not going to lie. It's a bit different when you've got 6,000 people at a festival, you're saying put your hands in the air or whatever you're saying, it's a generic thing, but when you've actually got people listening to what you're actually saying, you can't really say silly things like that. So let me jump in. Right, okay. I started DJing at the age of 14. I bought my first set of decks and practiced tirelessly every day for 4 years until the age of 18, landing my first gig at a local nightclub. In the 2 years following, I was juggling two jobs and everything was going very well, but I wasn't earning enough to DJ full time, which is what I wanted to do. So I decided to pack in my current job as a salesman and ventured overseas to pursue my DJ career further. I started it in the summer party resort of Malia in Greece. Things were going great, and in my first year alone, I worked my way up the ranks from the smallest bar to the biggest club, and things seemed to be going to plan. I then traveled to DJ in Tenerife and Bulgaria in the winters of 2009 and 2010, and in 2011, I went back to Malia to start what would be my third consecutive summer. On the 4th of July 2011, I was on my moped traveling between two neighboring villages in Crete when I turned left on a blind corner to be faced with a car overtaking on my side of the road. I swerved to avoid it, which consequently sent me into the metal barrier on the side of the road, at which point my brain switched off. Just aside from that, I'm told when the brain is aware it's going to go into massive trauma, it switches off. And when I do get my flashbacks, I'm very lucky to say that I don't actually know what happened. But what I do know is I woke up in the middle of the road, faced with, as you can imagine, a very ugly sight. After being in hospital for 7 days, I was discharged and told by the surgeon that saved my life, get this, that I was single-handedly the most difficult case they had had in Crete with the last... You're joking, mate. I don't think he saw the pun, but nevertheless. I spent 6 days out of hospital recovering and was bored for every second. The only thing I wanted to do was get back to what I loved doing, which was DJing. So that was that 14 days after losing my arm. I was DJing to 2,500 people for 45 minutes with 102 stitches in my arm. In hindsight, I was kind of crazy, but I didn't care at the time. I was touched to discover afterwards that every bar, club, restaurant, and tour operator manager in the island were in the club amongst the crowd. Upon returning to the UK, I received extensive care and rehab, but all I could think about was how much fun I was missing out on. Aside from that, I was watching videos. I'm very fortunate the club I worked at in Crete and built my reputation there. We had infamous people coming through. We're talking people that we can all relate to, like Tiny Temper, Devlin, Skepta, Labyrinth, very high profile people. And aside from this again, that's actually how I met Devlin. And Devlin's a top 10 artist. He's a rapper from Dagenham. And I tour with him as well, being his official tour DJ. Something as well, which I think would definitely never have happened if this hadn't have happened, because that's just the way life is. Where are we? Number three. So after being in the UK for 6 weeks, I booked my flight back out to Malia that year, and I was working 7 nights a week and loving every second. I felt I had very much unfinished business and was determined to finish the rest of the summer season, which I did. Fast forward to 2014, 4 radio shows, 1 world record, 19 countries later. I stand here telling you what many people in this room already know. Nothing is impossible. And the only limits you have in life are the ones that you set yourself. I have no secrets, no shortcuts to offer you, only the message that you can, or be, or do, absolutely anything in this world if you work hard and remain focused on the end result. I'm just an ordinary 26-year-old man who loves a party but hates a hangover. But on a serious note, I'd be lying if I said having this happen to me wasn't a good thing. It's changed my entire outlook on life. The way I look at things and my attitude towards everything. In fact, I said this to many people earlier on that spoke to me. If you gave me the opportunity to go back to where I was and continue on the path I was on with two arms, or have this on with one, I'll take this one every time. But I think some things in society need to change. For example, the term disabled, which I know many people are talking about. I know this has been, you know, discussed by many, but when will it change? I can do my job better than 75% of the DJs in the country, probably Europe, and I can back that up. But I'm the one that's branded disabled. The ignorance we are faced with from the general public on a regular basis, and in some cases discriminated against. I think a lot needs to be done to change this. I'd have to say a big thumbs up to, amongst others, Alex Brooker, for the work he is doing right now. I respect you a lot and wish you nothing but the best. If I could give you a round of applause, I would do, mate. I'd like to summarise by giving you three quotes that I live by, so much so that one of them is permanently tattooed across my chest. The two most important days of your life are the days you were born and the day you find out why. You don't know how strong you are until being strong is your only option. And finally, everything happens for a reason. Thank you for your time.
So what we're going to do is just spend a bit of time talking to Matt, and then obviously in a while invite you to ask your questions. But Matt, I want to start off really by talking about the journey, because you said, you know, you've got no shortcuts, there's no easy routes. Can you maybe talk us through that initial learning process that you did have to go through learn the difference of your life?
I was talking to Nigel about this earlier. I never really saw that I wasn't going to be DJing. I just knew that I was going to be DJing, but how the hell I was going to do it now, I don't know. Like, for example, when I said earlier that I DJed to 2,500 people 2 weeks after I lost my arm, I was DJing, and obviously the club was completely and utterly packed, but whilst I was DJing, I'd never practiced before in my life. I didn't know what I was doing, really. But all I knew was that I wanted to create a specific sound, and because I couldn't use my right arm anymore, it's not the end of the world, you just got to adapt, really, and just find out a different way of doing it. And that's all that life is. Everyone that's been through their journeys in this room today, it's about adaption. That's all it is. You adapt ways, you find ways. If you want to do something, you'll do it, but how are you going to do it? Well, make it happen. That's how you get. You just have to find the way that works for you. No one's right, no one's wrong. Everyone's different, and whatever works for you is the correct way.
And what about, you know, this? I've met quite a few people already today, you know, many different ages and so on, and there will be still youngsters here who have dreams of ambitions and goals,
sure,
of careers they want to pursue. Mm-hmm. You had one, you had to change to do it differently to how you do it now. What message have you got maybe for those youngsters who have those goals and aren't quite sure the route that they can take?
Passion. You've got passion, you've got everything. You've got passion for anything, whether it be DJing, dancing, like we saw earlier, playing a guitar, whatever you want to do. If you've got passion, that's the fundamental thing that you need to succeed. If you've got passion, you'll go, because you're, like I said earlier in my written down speech, you know, your limits are only set in your brain. If you think you can do it, you're right. If you think you can't do it, you're right. It just comes down to your way of thinking, and that's it. And getting back to your question. I rabble a lot.
I thought you answered it. I thought it was perfect. I was quite happy with that.
But for the youngsters in the room that want to get into DJing, or maybe, you know, some older guys that want to get into something, whether it be DJing or not, like I said, you know, you've got passion, you've got drive. Ignore every single person that's telling you you're doing right, you're doing wrong. You do your thing. And I'm absolutely certain you'll succeed. Absolutely certain. That's the only thing you need in my opinion.
Perfect. You know what? It's actually far more important to hear from the audience. So I'm sure many of you have probably got questions, so please fire away.
I'm just going to get a glass of water while you do that one second.
You carry on. Any questions at all? Who's got for Matt? Let's head at the back there.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Something I do want to say, because I always, this is why I write stuff, I always come away from interviews and radio shows, I'm like, I wish I said that. This is why I've written stuff out. I've just remembered another thing that's popped into my head. I get immense joy from traveling the world. I mean, I've been Mauritius for 7 weeks in December, I'm off to Australia, January, I'm literally everywhere. And what I take joy in the most is the ignorance, the people that don't quite know who you are, they've never seen you before, you know, you're gonna get that. And they judge you like that. This guy's got one arm, are you joking with me, this guy's a DJ. And I get immense joy from making them look silly at their job. Immense joy, let me tell you that.
Yes, sir.
Question. Yes, it's a difficult question to answer. Acceptance is kind of what a lot of us is at the back of our minds, more or less everyone in this room. I never really felt that I wasn't accepted because I just let actions speak louder than words. Like for people that were saying, like, you know, how does this guy DJ and ridiculing. My answer to that was setting a world record for the first guy, an amputee DJ, to DJ with four decks. I'm going to break it next year. I'm going to do five. And I've applied to Guinness, but they won't give me the official title because there's already a record set for most decks used, regardless of how many limbs you've got, I quote. So, okay. Each to their own. But, sorry, getting back to your question about acceptance, it's, to be honest, mate, it used to really bother me whether I was accepted. That was one of the first things that I thought. You know, I thought I was a good-looking lad. I was a pretty boy doing my hair. What am I going to look like? I've lost my arm. You know, it's not straightening my hair I've got to worry about anymore. It's what, you know, what shirt I'm going to wear. What's going to cover it? And over time, that eased, and I learned that you can just be yourself in society. And those that want to judge you. What was the quote? Those that care don't matter, and those that matter don't care.
Yes, sir.
Obviously, you train really hard, and I know a little bit about it. For 4 years, you train your body to work in a certain way.
Uh-huh.
What do you find most difficult about when you lost your arm? Because you obviously react in certain situations. You have to,
yep.
You have to like, retrain your style, your skills, those kind of things?
Yeah. I retrained everything, not just DJing. Like I said earlier, it's a case of adaption, you know. and almost what it comes to now is like thinking about what you're going to order in a restaurant, which I never thought you'd have to do. All of a sudden, you can't order steak medium rare because you can't cut it. So you have to ask the, you know, different things like that. So it's just adaption, you know. And let's get that involved with DJing. Adapting with DJing, it's DJing. This is going to sound very cliche. I'll apologise in advance, but it's my way of channeling all the energy, negativity, and crap that might be in your life. I try as best I can, I should say, to channel it through my DJing. The day my father died, I DJed that night. I DJed 7 nights a week throughout the summer. It's just my way of channeling my emotion, you know? And I think I'm very lucky to be able to discover that within 3.5 years of losing my arm. Because I think that's a trait that is extremely significant in my success, you know. It's quite crazy because a lot of the media in the world deem me as the only one arm DJ in the world. There's a couple, one of which is actually quite famous, but prefers not to go down the publicity route, and I respect that. But when a lot of these people jumped on the bandwagon, for example, in the Daily Mail, when all the national papers got involved and just jumped on the bandwagon, inverted comma, of being a one arm DJ, all you ever want as a musician, a percussionist, as a performer, is to be well known. So the media doing that work for me, as far as I was concerned, was perfect, you know. I'm suddenly in magazines in Australia and I've never been there, you know, it's insane. So if you just use what you've got and utilize it, I'm financially, emotionally, physically better off than I ever have been before in my life. Fact. And I wouldn't change this for the world, and I mean that. Hello. Okay. Yeah, absolutely, yeah. Excellent question. My attitudes have changed because now it's kind of weird. It's a very good question, actually, isn't it? I'm glad you brought it up because I did want to speak a little bit about this.
I would like to ask everybody
much. I'll do it for you. So the lady said, I don't know if you heard her, about if my attitude towards disability has changed since losing my arm, and also if you started with one arm, how would you feel about getting into DJing and being successful at that? My attitude towards disability has changed because I was one of the guys that we're all victim to, of double taking, and the general ignorance of, you know, you double take because it's just something that you're not used to seeing in daily life. We all double take, you know, whether we like to admit it or not. If you see an extremely obese person or a dwarf, if you see someone that's basically got a facial disfigurement, it's something that you're not used to knowing. And you're not used to seeing. That's why the double take happens. It's natural, it's human instinct. But from going from that person to being on the receiving end of the person that's receiving the double take, as we all, I'm sure many people in this room can relate to, if you're receiving the double take, and you happen to most people that you meet throughout the day, 7 days a week, 365 days of the year, you get the message. It's a difficult thing to deal with, very difficult, and that, for me, is the hardest thing. If you were to ask me the hardest thing, it's definitely that. The number one thing that I find most difficult is to deal with, is the people that double take. I can do absolutely everything else apart from butter toast and clap my hands. apart from, you know, I could deal with all that kind of stuff kind of well. You just adapt. But that's the ignorance of the double taking is just something that's very, very hard to become accustomed to. But, you know, I guess as you get more experience and you gather more maturity, that's hopefully something that I'd like to see change. And your second question about if you were already in a situation like mine and you wanted to get into DJing. I met a guy last night called Cyrus. Cyrus is 14 years old. Cyrus has got one hand. He's been DJing since he's 9. He's achieved more than I have in that space of time in comparison. In other words, reiterating what I'm saying is, after his 5 years of DJing, what he's achieved and the level of experience and knowledge that he was talking to me in surprised me and took me back. And I was giving him advice and explaining to him, you know, you are going to be very big. Don't stress about it. You're already on the path. It was amazing, and it was so cool to see his face. Like, he's talking, he said talking to me was like inspiring. It's like, it's not inspiring. If I can help you, mate, I'm just a guy that's talking to you. Okay, I've lost my arm. Whatever I can do to help anybody in this room, if I can help you in any way, just talk to me and I'll do what I can. I'm rambling. Going back to your question again about getting into it, just to finalize. You know, back to what we said earlier about passion. You've got passion. You know, it doesn't matter how many limbs you've got. There's a DJ in Germany who's got no hands. He just DJs with his feet on vinyl, old school, you know? It's just passion you need. It's just passion. You'd accelerate at a faster rate if you just disregard everything and just focus on the end result and what you want to do. Not what everyone thinks you should be doing, but what you want to do. Because it's your life, and we only get one. That's it. Thank you. Oh, one more, sorry.
I've got a question and a comment to make.
Okay.
The question is, has your sound changed? Has your style changed?
Yeah.
And the comment is, I think it's fantastic role. My son sounds good.
I appreciate that very much. Thank you very much indeed. I mean that. I'd like to... Yeah, my sound, sorry. It's different when you like face all these lights and you're like under it. My sound has changed. Yeah, it's a lot. I mean, it's kind of, we're talking musically. It's developed as the scene's got bigger. You know, house music is what I DJ. The scene's become very saturated with different things and different kind of fashion. But as terms of the sound, if we talk about my physical technical ability, okay, so before I would scratch, which in layman's terms, for those of the people in the room that don't know what that is, if you're scratching as a DJ, it's a basic requirement that you need two limbs. Not necessarily two hands, but two limbs, because it's two direct movements at once. So I can't do that anymore, obviously. So I now use my nose and my chin or my elbow or my foot. It depends on how big the stage is, I suppose. But my party trick is using effect on the mixer. And I'm going to do this to 6,000 people in 2 weeks. It will be filmed, I believe. So if you'd like to see it, I'm sure that will be available pretty soon. But my party trick is using effect on the mixer. I make a drum beat and use my mouth to adjust the pitch fader to create different sounds. So I can play White, I can play Seven Nations Army, I could play Usher, yeah, just like recognizable little catchy bits that I can play very quickly with my mouth and my finger. And again, sorry, talking about technical ability and how my sounds adapt. What I really wanted to do at once, I was talking to my press manager, and the way we wanted to go about doing it to kind of shut everybody up that was questioning my ability, because you always get someone that's behind a keyboard and thinks, you know, he's Jack the Lad. No matter how successful you are, how wealthy you are, how poor you are, you will always find someone that will speak derogatory about you or speak down to you because their life is probably less fortunate than yours, and that's what you have to remember. So the way that my press manager and I came up with shutting these people up was just by setting a world record. If I can do four decks, which is what most people with two arms can't do, then it's kind of shut a lot of people up, which is what it has. And that's helped my sound develop and helped my technical ability develop as well. So, yeah. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, what an inspiration. Matt House.